To a matter that is worrying a lot of you and the subject of a lot of correspondence. I spoke to Andrew Bolt yesterday about Australia's policy on Syria. We've donated $25 million to a United Nations appeal to help Syrians caught up in the civil war. The amount has been criticised by everybody. Oxfam, Care Australia say we should be giving more than $100 million. The UN says they need $11 billion. As Andrew Bolt made the point, well, there are 13.5 million people still inside Syria who are desperate. 6.5 million have been pushed out of their own homes, and we're to take 12,000 Syrian and Iraqi refugees. They'll be the winners in this lottery. And as I've said many times, God knows where what the thousands of Australians here who are homeless and jobless think about all of this. Where are the homes and jobs for these 12,000? The Institute of Family Studies reports only 7% of refugees granted visas in 2013 had jobs. 7%. A draft document prepared for the government and leaked last week warned that Syrian refugees, quote, will bring with them issues, beliefs or associations that lead them to advocate or engage in politically motivated or communal violence, unquote. I point out the past three terrorist attacks here were all carried out by Muslim refugees. The point that Andrew Bolt was making was that the aim of the exercise should be to create an environment where Syrian refugees eventually go home. So you first would attempt to destroy the terrorists and bring peace to the region, then have the refugees ready to return home when it's safe. Julie Bishop says, well, where's the money coming from? That's what she said, the foreign minister. Aid, she said, is not a bottomless pit. Where do we find the money? What would they like me to cut? Andrew Bolt made the point that you'd cut the 12,000 refugees, and that will save you $830 million minimum over 4 years. But there's a wider issue here. And it was asked recently in a brilliant piece by Douglas Murray, the young journalist from London, to whom I'll speak in a moment, the associate editor of Britain's Spectator magazine, when he asked, do we know what we're letting ourselves in for with 12,000 Syrian and Iraqi refugees? He's saying, look what happened in Europe. The European borders were opened by Angela Merkel and others, virtually the rest of the world, so-called refugees. Now, writes Douglas Murray, whether it was out of naive decency or cynical destruction, quote, there can be little doubt that the path on which its leaders have put the continent tends towards hell. He wrote in January, consider this month's news alone. The new year began with a mass sexual assault against German women carried out by migrants in the centre of Cologne. Such is the self-designated role of much of the media these days. The story didn't properly emerge for nearly a week. He said, for in Germany and many other countries across the continent, the media has decided its role is not to report the news, rather it's decided its role is to mediate between events and the possibly negative reactions of the general public, should they learn of such events. And as he said, if it weren't for a few gutsy websites, the news might have taken weeks or months to come out. He said, that's not so unlikely, because he said in Britain, when gangs of immigrant men in the north of England raped and abused as many as 1,400 girls, many underage, every arm of the state and much of the media worked to keep the facts and the identities of the attackers secret for 15 years. Writes Douglas Murray, it took the resignation of Cologne's police chief to partly alleviate the scandal. But the manner in which the story came out points to a fascinating reality, he said, in modern Europe. He said the media, politicians and almost every arm of the state in the new Europe treat the general public as though we're a powder keg, likely to go off at any moment. Douglas Murray is on the line from London. Douglas, good morning.
Very good to be with you.
Thank you for your time. We're going to take 12,000 of these. What is the warning for us?
Well, the warning has to be that you better know what you're doing. You better know what the next stages are. All of our politicians in Europe in the last few years have seen there as being only brownie points to be got for being open-hearted, as they say, about refugees. Now they're realizing that there is actually a potential price for them to pay, and indeed a price for everybody to pay. It is very easy for politicians to be generous on behalf of other people, but it's quite a different thing being generous yourself. And it's quite a different thing being naive on behalf of other people, because the only people not to have thought through the consequences of the mass migration into Europe. And it's very important to remember that most of the people, by the European Union's own standing now, are not actually legitimate asylum seekers. The majority of them, the European Commission now admits, are actually simply economic migrants. But nobody apart from the people in power could not have foreseen that the mass movement of thousands of people is merely the beginning of a story, the very beginning of it, and that the way in which it rolls out will have utterly incalculable consequences for years to come.
Well, Merkel has taken a million of these. The German people are starting to wake up, aren't they? That's 1% of their 80 million population. Last year, Sweden, with a population of around 10 million, was taking up to 10,000 every week. And as you just said, these are not asylum seekers. These are economic refugees. You see them on the television. They're young men from Africa and the Middle East.
Yes. Chancellor Merkel is going to go down in the history books for this. This moment when effectively, Europe's external borders went down. And, of course, one of the main aims of the European Union project was to also take down internal borders, borders between European Union countries. So that's what allowed this to happen. Now, somebody rather wittily said on, I think, Twitter at the time, that Chancellor Merkel reminded them of one of those girls you sometimes read about who in the news, whose parents have gone away for the weekend, and she's said on Facebook that she's got a spare house for a party, and of course the whole world descends, and the next thing you read is that she's had to call the police. That's exactly what Chancellor Merkel ended up doing. She opened the door, she announced to the world that Europe's doors were open, and then suddenly panicked because the world was arriving. Too late, of course, too late. By the European Commission's own estimates, as I say, the majority of these people should not be here. That means that Germany, if you go by the European Commission's own estimates, which I think are very low, that means that Germany now has to deport almost 750,000 people who've arrived in the last year alone. The Swedish government is now trying to talk tough, having been so reprehensibly stupid in recent months. The Swedish government is now saying it's going to deport up to 80,000 people who shouldn't be there. Of course, we all know that's nonsense. Everybody knows that's nonsense. Everybody who is looking and wondering whether they'll come next year realizes this is nonsense.
And of course,
Sweden isn't going to deport those people. Germany isn't going to deport those people.
And of course, the people have only one redress, don't they? And that is to speak as they've spoken in Sweden. The Sweden Democrats, who are just a fringe party, as you say, derided by so many of their critics, have now surged ahead in the recent polls. I mean, you've got to see the rise of Donald Trump in America.
Yes.
You know, that is a consequence of this, isn't it?
Yes. When people complain that they don't like what's happening in the politics around this, they should simply realize that mainstream political parties and mainstream politicians have been failing the public time and again. And, you know, I have to point to your own country like every other country in this regard. You know, every single time a terrorist lets off a bomb or cuts somebody's head off and shouts Allahu Akbar, the Australian Prime Minister, the American President, the British Prime Minister tells everyone this has nothing to do with Islam, for instance. Everyone can see that it's only got to do with Islam. Otherwise, they wouldn't be saying Allahu Akbar. But this, like the migrant crisis, because it's so welded to it, what we're seeing is the result of an entire political class across the world that has refused to be honest with the public, refused to be honest with the public about Islamic extremism, refused to be honest with the public about the consequences of mass immigration. And you can't then blame the general public for going elsewhere for their leaders.
No, they're on a holiday from reality, as I've said many times, Douglas, a holiday from reality. I mean, Merkel said, listen, these are mainly young people. They could assist the greying German population by providing the labour force for the next generation. Never mind the labour force had no jobs to go to. We've got people here, thousands and thousands of them, homeless, unemployed. Now we're going to be asked to find homes and jobs for 12,000 whom we don't know.
Exactly. I mean, does anybody not see the long-term consequences of this. You know, the idea that, as I say, it's the very beginning of the process. As you rightly say, what jobs are they going to have? Where are they going to live? How are they going to be sustained? You know, I mean, my own view that publics in countries like Australia, like Britain, are very generous to genuine asylum seekers.
Correct.
But our generosity is not without without limit. And there are lots of things that by now our political leaders should be discussing. They should be discussing what temporary asylum means. Is it possible we could actually give some people asylum, but it's only until their country is put back together and then they go back? They don't stay here forever, they don't become Australian, they don't become British. It's a temporary arrangement. If the public had any confidence that that was going to happen, I think people wouldn't mind allowing people in on a temporary a deal. But what we all know is that once you're into Australia, you stay.
That's
once
it.
You're into Europe, you stay. And so we have no trust in our leaders.
See, this Douglas Murray, you've heard the voice. This is a young man. So people are saying, who is this fellow? He's a young man. And it's refreshing to hear young journalists speak like this. You wrote this, which I thought was quite magnificent. While the glow of moral effervescence may have briefly hung around those leaders who said, refugees welcome, the story was bound to have a second act, and that was always due when the next turn of the wheel brought negative stories associated with the refugees. The concern from people here, Douglas, is we've signed on to all this.
Oh, yes, of course you have. We all have. and as I say, the one thing you can do to get out of it is to ask the questions now that people don't want to ask. You know, find out what system the Australian government has in place to vet the people coming in. I bet you will find, like the system that Europe pretends to have, that it is no system. After allowing in 1.3 million people, Chancellor Merkel suddenly said, when they realised anti-Semitic incidents were going up in Germany, suddenly said, we don't want anti-Semites. OK, Chancellor Merkel. OK, Australian politicians. What is your policy? What is your infrastructure to vet the views of people who do come into Australia? What is your system to make sure that the people coming in are not anti-Semites? What is your system to make sure that the people coming in don't think that women in Australia are uncovered meat who can be molested at any stage that they want to? What is your view to make sure that the views of the people coming in do not go completely against the mainstream views of decent liberal, in the best sense of the term, Australian society? I bet you will find that the system doesn't exist.
It hasn't existed. Haven't even thought of it. And as you say, the same problems of impossible integration and impossible rage will continue to grow. You said, although there were neither homes nor jobs for the migrants to go to, letting them in turned out to be the easy part. The real problems are just starting.
Yes. And this is going to go on for years and years. The easiest stage in the world is to look like you're being generous. As I say, to be generous with other people's money, i.e. taxpayers' money, to pretend, as a lot of politicians in Britain did, that they were themselves going to take in Syrian families. Not one of the politicians who said that currently has a Syrian family living with them. Of course they don't. That is the easiest thing in the world to boast about. The hardest thing is what a country does with thousands of people arriving whose views we don't know, who there is no system in place to vet. That is the hard part, and that is one that is going to go on for
Absolutely.
All of our lifetimes and beyond.
And that's what you said, the citadel of political correctness or generous humanitarian superpower, as Sweden likes to call itself, has been brought to earth by inescapable reality. It's very good to talk to you, Douglas Murray, and I really thank you for your time, and I look forward to talking to you again.
Look forward to it.
There he is, Douglas Murray. There are hard lessons in Australia here for bleeding hearts like the Greens' Senator Hanson Young. I must say, Malcolm Turnbull has made this point quite well in the wake of the High Court decision, but what's to happen to these 12,000? What lessons are there in us for Europe, and can we learn those lessons before it's too late?